Olá, meus amigos, bem-vindos à programação em língua portuguesa aqui no Canal 49. Com muito gosto que estamos na vossa companhia para mais uma edição do programa Os Portugueses no Vale, que há quase 30 anos está ao serviço da comunidade de língua e de origem portuguesa aqui neste vastíssimo Vale de São Joaquim, o Canal 49, com os seus telespectadores desde o Sul, desde a cidade de Bakersfield, no Sul, até à zona de Merced do Norte e, obviamente, através da internet em qualquer parte do mundo. O programa Os Portugueses no Vale, sempre a falar das vivências portuguesas em terras americanas. E hoje o nosso programa, a maioria do nosso programa, vai ser no idioma inglês, mas a falar da presença portuguesa aqui neste centro deste estado. Temos hoje uma convidada que é sobejamente conhecida por muitos dos nossos amigos telespectadores, particularmente as famílias aqui do Vale de São Joaquim, e é com ela que vamos conversar durante cerca de 22 minutos e depois, no fim, faremos um breve resumo, digamos assim, sobre o que foi dito em português para os nossos amigos telespectadores que ainda não falam inglês, mas praticamente toda a gente hoje em dia fala um pouco da língua inglesa. Então, vamos passar para inglês. Permaneçam connosco em programas portugueses no Vale até, portanto, sempre nas manhãs de terça, ao meio-dia de sexta e nas tardes de sábado. Passamos agora para a língua inglesa. It is my pleasure to welcome to Channel 49 and to the program Os Portugueses no Vale a young lady who is a familiar face here in the San Joaquin Valley, who has been part of this valley for many years, who left this valley, came back this valley, and that is the First Lady of the California State University, Fresno, Fresno State, as we know it, and First Lady Mary Castro, who is a Portuguese-American, a proud Portuguese-American, and who has contributed immensely, not just to the Portuguese-American community, but to the entire valley educational community throughout the years. First Lady Mary Castro, welcome.
Thank you. Thank you for having me here.
My pleasure. Let's talk about, first of all, I know that most of our viewers know who Mary Castro is. They've seen you on social media, on the regular media, and your involvement in, because you've taken a very untraditional maybe role of First Lady First Lady of Fresno State because of your involvement at the university at various levels. Yes. But let's start a little bit with the family. I know that, as I mentioned in Portuguese, you are a Portuguese background. Tell us a little bit about yourself.
Yes, well, my maiden name is Borges, and I grew up in Layton. My dad milked cows for over 40 years. My parents are Manuel and Mary Borges. And I came from a very large Portuguese family. My dad's the oldest of nine. There were seven boys and two girls, so I had my grandparents had a ranch that was in Layton that was north of the cemetery, and I just that's what I knew growing up was a very rich Portuguese family, rich in culture, rich in love and support with a very strong work ethic, and that's what I hoped to bring to my role in serving others at Fresno State and in our community.
Now, Dr. Castro, your husband was appointed president of Fresno State. How many years ago? Just a few years.
In 2013. We came here in August of 2013.
And after that, you took on a role as kind of the chief volunteer for everything that is good for our students. Tell us about some of the projects right now. And actually, in the month of March, we have a very interesting project. And if you could tell our viewers about that and maybe entice them to still help us out.
Well, it's a very exciting time at Fresno State. We have so many great programs going on that help our students to reach their level of success in their educational goals. And when we did come back to Fresno, we felt like we hit the lottery, that we could come home and serve where we grew up. My husband grew up in Hanford, and we even joked that we could have met many years before we actually did start dating, because We were marching in some of the same festas. He was carrying the saints for the Hanford or for some other areas, and I would be marching in the processions for the Queens for Riverdale or for Hanford and for some of my cousins. And so we realized we were in the same spot at the same time, but we didn't start dating until he was 18 and I was 17 years old. But there isn't a defined role for the spouse of a university president. And so there's a lot of flexibility depending upon what your passion is or your desire to be involved. Right. And while I did not have an academic background, I do feel that I could contribute. Mm-hmm. And I did feel that I could contribute. And so once we arrived, I just did a lot of listening on the campus to find out if and to make myself available to serve and to let them know that I would be willing to roll up my sleeves and do anything. You know, growing up in a family that had an agricultural base, you look at what the problem is and right. what you have on hand and you make it work. Right. And so when we were first made aware that we had students who were not having enough to eat, and if they didn't have enough to eat, you can't concentrate, you can't do your best work. And at the heart of everything that you do, you have to feel empowered and strong. And that's where we started the Fresno State Student Cupboard. That's a free...
Explain a little bit about that.
Yes, yeah. That's a free food pantry for mm-hmm. our students. And we called it the cupboard because of that came from Maya Va. And I brought Maya Va's picture here. This is Josephine Borges. And she was I was fortunate to be the oldest granddaughter in the family because my father's the oldest son. And I spent a lot of time right beside her cooking and learning about our family and about who we are and as people and what our responsibility is to take care of those around us. And so I tell this story, and you invited me to welcome some Portuguese language students mm-hmm. to Fresno State, and I relay this to them because I want them to understand the value of their culture and how you can translate what you learn as being a Portuguese person into what you do, not to dilute it, not to let it be taken away from you over time, but to be proud of it. And so that's why I always honor my grandmother whenever I speak of my work or whenever I talk about the student cupboard, because at the heart of it, every day when my dad would finish milking cows, we would get in the car and we'd go over to my grandma's house, and some of my other aunts and uncles would be there with their my cousins, and it was just a big gathering of us. And when you walked in that screen door, you heard the door creak, and there would be my Ava. She was a tiny woman, but very mighty, and she would be in her smock that she had sewn herself, and there would be delicious food, and she'd give you that hug, and she'd give you a blessing, and she'd give you that hug, and you knew in that moment that you were the most precious, valuable thing to her, and you were just enveloped in love, and that's how I wanted our students to feel. So once we heard that this was an issue, we had to do something about it. And today, the student cupboard, which we opened in November of 2014, we have over 10,000 visits a month.
Wow.
So my Ava's legacy has went on to not only feed her children, her grandchildren, and many others that she used to take care of in our community, but now it has rippled out to where it's through me, she were able to have that same type of spirit where our students can come into the student cupboard when they need it. Mm-hmm. They can get a basket, help shop for food, fruits and vegetables. We have many alumni that are successful in the ag business, mm-hmm. and so they give us their coals, and we have at any time throughout the year, we have a great variety of items, and we have hygiene products too, diapers for the students who are parents. It's made a great difference in their lives. And they tell, when I'm in there and I'm helping with stocking the shelves or I'm bringing people through for a tour so they can see it, students share their stories with you. And they let us know that this is making the difference in them being able to stay in school and finish. And right. I'm very proud of that.
You should be. And I'm sure Grandma's looking down from heaven at you and smiling big smiles. Uh-huh. Because this is exactly what a few years ago at one of the Luso American Education Foundation conferences that you and Dr. Castro hosted last year, in March of last year. About 4 years ago, when a conference had been here before, one of our keynote speakers, actually a Portuguese-American, just like you, of second generation, mentioned something, and he said, it is up to us to take this cultural bond that we've gotten from our parents and our grandparents and serve and be transformative in the American world. And that's exactly what you're doing. You didn't basically take those that family heritage,
right,
okay, from your parents and your grandparents and stayed with it in your family, which is already great. But when you can use that to transform society, that's great. That's fantastic.
Thank you
so much.
Thank you.
That's exactly what we need in the Portuguese American community, to basically not just live those values, but to use them to transform society. And First Lady Mary Castro has done that at Fresno State. Another project that you, or kind of a tradition that you began at Fresno State, and you shared it with our students, as First Lady Mary Castro mentioned, we had 300 students from five different high schools just a few weeks ago at Fresno State for what we call an annual Portuguese language students, because it's students of all ethnicities who learn Portuguese at different high schools, a discovery day at Fresno State for them. Hopefully many of them will be Fresno State students.
Yes.
I hope so. And they are, it's a wonderful event, and it's usually around the Portuguese Immigrant Week that is declared every week by whoever is governor at the time here in California. And you spoke about the hugs, and I think it's just a lovely story, and it's, again, a transformative story and a story of love that one can have at all levels, including the academic world.
Yes.
Yeah.
Well, I think that, you know, going with your instinct, sometimes people are so worried about the way that they're perceived that they edit out these things that make us unique. And, you know, growing up in our family, everybody was very physical.
Right.
That you got the hug. You got the hug coming and going and the kiss and everything. And so you started saying goodbye half an hour before you planned on getting in your car because it was going to take a while. But that's all part of it, right?
Yeah.
And so when I was invited to the first year we had commencement at Fresno State, President Castro participates in all of them, of course. And my job was kind of more behind the scenes. When the platform party would come off, I would help them take off their regalia and feed them and give them something to drink. And then the next one would start in a little bit, and I'd get them all back dressed, and they'd go out. And that first year, I was invited to participate in one, and that was the very last one on the Saturday, and it was the Chicano Latino graduation. And for that one, the Save Mart Center had, there were 860 graduates. There were about 10,000 people in attendance for that ceremony in 2014. And I was invited to participate, so I walked with President Castro and the rest of the platform committee down through these throngs of family members with little cousins and everybody there, so excited, because we have over 70% of our students at Fresno State are first in their family to attend. So this whole family has pulled together to make it possible for this student to reach that goal. And when we got up there, the person who was in charge of making sure everything stayed on track had said, all right, all of you, we're going to get out of here in the right time. You know the rules. And I go,
what are
the rules? Nobody told me the rules. And so and it's very festive. There's dancing, there's mariachis. And I go, well, you know, just enjoy it, because you're never going to get invited back again. And so when the leading up to commencement, we have different banquets that recognize different student groups. And one group that we had hosted at our home was the Renaissance Scholars. And that's a group of students that come in as a cohort, and they are students who have aged out of the foster care system. So once they turn 18, many of them don't have a connection to a home or family. Fresno State becomes their home and their family. And at that banquet that we had, one of those students was going to be the Dean's Medalist for his college, which is the highest honor that you can have. And he was saying how hard he had worked, but that he was sad because there wouldn't be anybody there at his graduation to celebrate with him. And then I had heard that story a few more times from other groups, that either because of death or distance or some other circumstance, that this student who worked so hard was going to be walking across that stage alone. So in that moment, when we were there on that stage, and the very first student came up, I was so proud of that student. The same type of pride and love for that student and for their achievement as I felt for our own son when he graduated from UC Berkeley. And so I looked to the person who was heading the graduation ceremonies that time, and I said, "Can I hug him?" And she said, "You can do whatever you want." And so I hugged all 860 of them that night, and I just did it out of instinct, out of love, out of wanting that student and every student that was graduating that night to know that even if I didn't know their name, I was proud of them and they were not alone. And now it's grown every year, and students, they write me letters. The families post things online saying what it meant to them. And that was never my intention. It was just a gift of love. But in doing that gift was given to me.
Right.
That
right.
gift of love was given to me. And if I keep it to myself, then
right.
that's the end of it.
That's right.
But to be able to give it out and then to see the way that other people respond. So last year, I was invited to a lot more ceremonies, and it's grown every year, and I hugged about 1,800 students in 2 days. So I'm already doing my exercises
right.
for this year. Yes. But so I've become kind of known as the hugger. And I love it that if I'm around campus, especially I'm in the elevator during finals or midterm time, and students will recognize me and they'll say, "Mrs. Castro, can I have a hug?" And I give them a hug because I love them. I love them. I'm proud of them. I know how hard their families work for them to be there. I know how hard they work to stay there. And they do it because they have hope.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
They believe that they have a positive role in the future of our community. That's who I want to invest in.
And that's just fantastic, because that's what college is all about. It's not only
yeah.
what you learn in the books. It's not only the scientific world, but it's also tying it into who you are and who you can be, you know, for society. And I
right.
must share with our viewers that when Mrs. Castro told the story, when First Lady Mary Castro told the story a few years ago, I think the first time, to our students anyway, it was like 2 years ago.
Yes.
And I had a young lady who is now in college, and she told me, two of them actually, she said, I'm going to go to Fresno State. I'm going to be the first in my family to go to Fresno State, and I'm going to get a hug from Mrs. Castro. So that's
yes.
wonderful that high schoolers can also connect to that, you know, and so thank
yes.
you for sharing the message with our viewers and obviously with the kids here a couple of weeks ago. Let's talk a little bit about some of this work that you do, the volunteer work, all of this work that you do,
mm-hmm.
which is basically around the clock. You also, of course, most of this is, as you said, like the cupboard is, it's basically through donations.
Yes.
So how important is the community involvement? Those who have a little bit more than others, or those
yes.
who are, whether they are or not, Fresno State's alumni, how can they get involved and also take part in this movement that you and Dr. Castro have started to kind of, mm-hmm. to, as you know, we like to say, you know, these bold moves, but they are bold moves because
yes.
they empower people.
Yes. Well, the month of March is our main campaign for gathering all the funding that we need to run the cupboard, because we don't use state funds for the cupboard. And we have, it takes a little over $100,000 a year to run it at the level that we have it. This year we have Moss Adams, Granville Homes, and an anonymous donor who are willing to match up to $100,000.
Wow.
And so far, to date, we have about $62,000 raised. We go all the way until midnight on the last day of March. And whatever we raise that goes above the operating costs, we're going to start a permanent endowment for the student cupboard to make sure that it's there, that our students know this resource will be there for them. And there are a variety of ways to engage and to give. Every gift counts,
mm-hmm.
because giving $100 becomes $200 during
Correct.
The month of March. And we are so fortunate to have so many people from the Portuguese community specifically give, because
mm-hmm.
they know that connection with Yoruba. You
right.
know, when we would come home from college, we called it the cupboard, because when we would come home before we were going to leave, a lot of our Avas didn't know exactly what college what was happening on the campus, but they knew we needed to eat.
Mm-hmm.
And so they would go through their cupboards, and they didn't give from extra, they gave from what they had.
That's right.
And that, I always try to honor that, because that's the important part. They gave from what they had. And they put together a bag, and that was able to get President Castro and our family through the last few weeks of the month several times. And so that's why we named it the Fresno State Student Cupboard. They can give by going online. They can go to fresnostate.edu/marchmatchup. If they go to the Fresno State website, they Google it, there'll be a place there that they can click. If they are on any of the social media outlets of Twitter or Facebook, we have the student cupboard. Mm-hmm. We have great videos where the students talk mm-hmm. about what this means to them. And it's wonderful to see the students in their own words tell what it means to them, because it's very empowering to know that people you don't even know believe in you.
That's right. That is. That truly is. As we come to the end of our conversation, a great conversation. Mm-hmm. It's great to interview First Lady Mary Castro because she is a wonderful speaker. Let's talk a little bit about Portuguese at Fresno State.
Yes.
I mean, I'm excited because I'm part of it, but even if I wasn't, we're all excited about it. I think the Portuguese American community is excited about it.
Yes.
Thanks to Dr. Castro for giving us this opportunity. As many of you, of our viewers may know, the first thing that Dr. Castro did once she, you know, started running Fresno State basically was to start a Portuguese presence, Portuguese Leadership Council
yes.
of different people from throughout the valley. And from there, you know, we have now a full tenure professor that was hired to teach Portuguese. We have something called Portuguese Beyond Borders Institute that
yes.
we featured here on Channel 49. So I know that you, I know that you and Dr. Castro talk about this, and so I know we all know in the Portuguese American community, maybe our own little secret, but we all know that First Lady Mary Castro has a lot to do with this Portugueseness, but also Dr. Castro in his wonderful speech at the opening ceremonies of the Portuguese Beyond Borders Institute mentioned that, you know, he has felt he has been part of this Portuguese-American community, not just through marriage, but who he has been in the
yes.
valley for all these years. So
yes.
how tell us a little bit about how you feel about what's going on with Portuguese at Fresno State as well.
I could not be happier. And number one, to have you leading the Portuguese
well,
Institute,
and
you didn't pay me to say that, so we're good. I have felt for a long time that the contributions that the Portuguese community make to our region and to the state are, you know, magnificent.
Good.
And to share that, to let other people know. And it's being proud of who you are, but to also educate others that we are here and that these are the different ways that we are helping to make our area stronger. I was so excited to meet the President Cordero
yes.
that you brought, and I was just thinking of my family from Terceira, what they would think that here the milker's daughter is meeting the president from the Azores, and it was just thrilling, and to hear his vision of the future of the Azores, and the lecture that he gave, I felt like it was one of the best lectures that we've hosted at Fresno State, and that's across all different areas. And I thank you for thinking on that level with the type of programming that you are planning, with the panels that you've devised. I really want people of the Portuguese community to come and to start to participate in these events that you are planning, because they are above and beyond anything we've ever seen in our area.
Well, thank you, but it's a group work, and it's carrying on the vision of your husband and yours. So that's all I'm doing. Let's be clear about that.
You're very modest.
But the thing that is, I had a student tell me, and I'd like to share this with our viewers, that she's a Portuguese language student who's just learning the Portuguese language,
yes.
Not a Portuguese background, and she said, I want to speak Portuguese like President Cordero speaks English, because he spoke
yes.
very well. We thought we were very
fantastic.
Well English.
Fantastic,
yeah.
Yes.
For someone who is not his first language or his dominant language. But also the words that President Castro used mm-hmm. on the opening ceremony, that Fresno State the vision is for Fresno State to be kind of the hub for everything that is Portuguese around the academic and the cultural world
yes.
In the valley. That is so important because our community, as you know, First Lady Mary Castro, is changing.
Mm-hmm.
We no longer have immigrants like we had 35, 40, 50 years ago.
Right.
So the community becomes a lot more Americanized. And so some of the things that we used to have 50 years ago, we no longer have. Some of
yes.
the things that we had 30 years ago, we no longer have. So kind of the educational world has to take over, like it's happened
right.
with other groups. You know, the Armenian community is an example, and many, many others. And I thank you for your vision. I think that's,
yes.
that's going to be important to have Fresno State link this with our community.
Well, and I think, too, that, you know, generational-wise, you start to lose the confidence in the accuracy of what you're being told. And so the stories that I heard from my grandparents, my father was 8 years old when he immigrated, my grandfather was 8 years old when he immigrated from Terceira on my father's side, but I remembered him talking about the Azores. But my children don't get that benefit.
Correct.
And I don't want them to not have a resource where they can go and they can learn about their heritage from this side of their family. And I want it to be authentic. And right. I want to know that it's trusted. And that is the very great value of the Portuguese Beyond Borders Institute, because then we can have this new generation that, even though we want them to embrace the fact that they are Americans, we don't want them to forget what's in their heart.
We all came from somewhere.
That's
true.
Right.
Thank you so much for visiting with us. Thank you for being here on Channel 49. Thank you for being with the program. Thank you for all you do.
You're welcome. And
best of luck. And we'll be working together for many great things for our students, hopefully.
Thank you.
E, meus amigos, assim estivemos com a primeira-dama da Universidade Estadual da Califórnia em Fresno, a senhora Mary Borges Castro, portanto, a esposa do presidente Joseph Castro, que, portanto, há 6 anos atrás foi nomeado presidente da Universidade Estadual da Califórnia em Fresno e que nos últimos 6 anos tem feito, de facto, maravilhas para a nossa, para toda a comunidade aqui do centro da Califórnia e criado um espaço para a nossa comunidade de origem portuguesa. Com a senhora Mary Castro falamos de vários temas, mas falamos essencialmente da presença da língua e da cultura portuguesas na Universidade Estadual da Califórnia em Fresno. Falamos da necessidade das pessoas de colaborarem com a universidade. A universidade cada vez mais é um espaço para todos nós, não é um espaço apenas onde os vossos filhos ou os vossos netos vão aprender, mas também é um espaço onde eles vivem 4, muitas vezes 6, 8 anos da sua vida e, portanto, temos que ter uma ligação entre a universidade e a comunidade. Essa ligação que nos liga e essa ligação que faz parte de quem somos. A senhora Mary Castro também partilhou em inglês, obviamente, esta ligação que ela tem, que é muito especial com a sua avó, e é muito especial, de facto, esta ligação das pessoas dos Açores, particularmente com os seus avós. Eu uma vez tive uma pessoa que me disse, um sacerdote aqui na Califórnia, que me disse, sacerdote português, que nunca tinha visto como na cultura açoriana esta ligação profunda entre os avós e os netos. E foi muito bonito ver aqui a senhora Mary Castro falar precisamente desta ligação com a sua avó, que foi essa ligação com que a fez, portanto, fazer o que tem feito ao longo destes anos todos no Fresno State, como uma figura transformadora desta nossa comunidade. Foi com muito gosto que estivemos convosco aqui no Canal 49, o programa Os Portugueses no Val. Mais uma vez, agradecemos a vossa paciência, agradecemos a vossa sintonia e agradecemos aqueles que colaboram com o programa Os Portugueses no Val e que continuem a colaborar também com a Universidade Estadual da Califórnia em Fresno, com o Fresno State e tudo o que é português à volta desta nossa presença portuguesa em terras americanas. É imperativo que o legado dos portugueses e luso-americanos na Califórnia continue e floresça durante muitos e muitos anos. Para isto e por isso, aqui está também o programa Os Portugueses no Val. Foi com muito gosto que estivemos na vossa companhia. Um abraço para todos. Não se esqueçam que o nosso programa está convosco 3 vezes por semana, terças, sextas e sábado. Um abraço. Até sempre.